Good evening and welcome to Arizona Horizon. I'm Ted Simons. Joining me tonight are Mary Jo Pitzel of the Arizona Republic, Howard Fisher of Capital Media Services, and Jeremy Duda of the Arizona Capital Times. The legislative session is over. Lawmakers wrapped up their work last night. Pretty much as expected. No real surprise there, correct?
Right. No last-minute bills. I mean, there were a couple of last-minute maneuvers, but no surprises. They cleared the desk of a lot of the sort of flotsam and jetsam that had been hanging around the rest of the session and spent their last couple of hours working on tax cuts, the governor's personnel reform, and a skirmish over Colorado City.
And I think they wanted to go home. Remember, this is an election year. A lot of these folks are hoping to get elected either back to the legislature, perhaps some of them to Congress. And the longer they hang around here, less time they have to go out there and beat the bushes.
One of the softer landings of a legislative session in a while?
Yeah, I mean, this thing goes till, 1, 2 in the morning. Sometimes people start bringing up random striker bills and stuff you never heard of and God knows what. So it's pretty easy last night.
All right, let's get to a variety of things. We'll start, Mary Jo, with the budget. Give us an overview. We had some modest increases in revenue, but we also had the legislature kind of getting their way on some things as well. Give us an overview.
The budget got approved on Tuesday. The fine print came out Tuesday morning, and there was a vote by Tuesday afternoon. So, the usual cries of lack of transparency and lack of preparation. But there is a little more revenue in the budget. They're going to spend a little more. There's differing estimates, depending if you talk to the governor's office or the legislative offices. They all chop their numbers up differently. But there are increases. The governor got money that she wanted for some welfare programs, for seriously mentally ill, for reading assistance for young kids, a little bit for building repairs on the school front. The big win for lawmakers was they got this $450 million rainy day fund. The fund exists. They put $450 million into it, saying we need this cushion because, remember, that penny tax is going away, and then we've got federal health care reform, and who knows what else is going to happen.
And that's really the key. This was... who won? Everybody asks, well, who won on this? The legislators wanted that savings account. And to the extent that they recognized that they had to give something to the governor, sure, the $40 million for the K-3 reading makes sense. You've got a law that's going to take effect basically in 2 years, say you can't read at third grade level, you don't get go on to the fourth grade. So that became an easy one for them. Everyone is worried about what's going to happen. We saw a meeting of the Finance Advisory Committee last month, and the economist said, you know how we were predicting this big increase in revenues? Well, we're not sure about 2015 anymore.
And I think that's probably one of the things that kind of strengthened the legislature's bargaining position. At least a lot of folks over there feel like it, because the governor had been insisting on her revenue numbers for a while. And once that came out, they said, okay, well, your numbers are realistic. So she kind of had to come to the table and deal. She gave up some education money she wanted, and she acknowledged the other day, said, yeah, I didn't get everything I wanted, but I still got this money for DES, still got it for seriously mentally ill. So.
But it's a lot of education money. I mean, she wanted $200 million in what they call soft capital, which is books and computers and everything else. And essentially, there's a little $15 million capital money in there. It just didn't exist. I mean, there's a lot of money she left on the table.
Right, and the trick here was that the Democrats had come out with a budget where they spent less than the governor. So the Republicans saw that, and as they were going back and forth with the governor about, well, how much should we spend this year, they threatened to forge an alliance with the Democrats, saying, okay, we'll get a two-thirds majority and we can override you, Governor, on a budget if you don't come down on your estimate of how much money we got to spend. And that sort of brought the governor's position down, because you certainly don't want to be painted as a Republican governor spending more than those spend-happy Democrats in the legislature.
Was that a serious bargaining chip there? Because we heard different accounts. At first, people were saying, poo-pooing a little bit, but longer it went, more we heard about this.
Look, politics is the art of possible. We've seen coalition budgets in the past. Probably what Chad Campbell would want in return for his votes might be some of the quote-unquote reforms in the tax system. But yeah, they would have done what they needed to do. There would be a price to pay. The Democrats might have gotten $7 million in there for the kids' care to restore that. They would have gotten some more developmentally disabled money. So yes, if you give the Democrats what they want, they're happy to provide the votes.
Did Democrats wind up having any input at all other than this kind of peripheral sort of thing.
As usual, none. I mean, whatever impact they had was probably, as you know, the Republicans using them as leverage. I heard someone earlier this week compare, you know, Chad Campbell to Charlie Brown and the governor to Lucy pulling the football up.
Yeah. Okay. And so as far as kids care is concerned, Mary Jo, soft capital, as how I mentioned, Zippo.
Right. Now, kids care, remember, there was an agreement with the hospitals, so they're bringing back a lot of the coverage of kids care. But groups such as the Children's Action Alliance, the Democrats kept saying, you know, if we just got another $7 million, we could restore it up to the levels, we could serve all the kids that we were serving before that number. And the governor's office would not budge.
Well, and let's now get to this tax cut package that passed kind of late in the session here, because we've heard from some of the folks that wanted to see an increase in revenue regarding children's issues and health issues and such, and they're saying, you're putting $450 million away for a rainy day and for all this stuff on the distance, and you're also putting more tax cuts out there, which is going to hurt revenue from their perspective as well.
And Linda Lopez said this one tax bill alone, she figured by FY19 we were going to be losing $100 million a year. Now, the problem becomes how you look at it. If you ask Steve Yarbrough, he'll say, yes, we will not have these dollars. But if we cut the capital gains, people are going to have more money in their pocket. They will go out and invest, and that will create jobs, which will employ more people who will pay more taxes. The problem I've always had with this whole issue of capital gains is me buying and selling McDonald's stock, I haven't seen that creating more jobs in Arizona.
And you talk to a lot of economists. I mean, that's highly disputed. You talk to a lot, and they'll say, no, this has no impact on whether or not people are creating jobs, because you know, a lot of the times they're just buying and selling stocks. It's not creating jobs for people. But that bill started off a lot bigger than it ended up. You know, originally the plan was a total phase out of capital gains taxes, and the governor's office, you know, put its foot down pretty much from day one during the legislative session. And Andy Tobin and J.D. Mesnard, who were pushing the bill, they spent most of the session trying to find a way to make it palatable to the ninth floor.
And as far as, again, we're talking 25% individual capital gains cuts here. We're talking cuts to businesses as far as their equipment is concerned.
Yes.
And this loss, this forward loss now was 5 years, now it goes to 20 years.
Yeah. And this is an interesting provision that may make some sense. Right now, if you have a loss, you can carry it forward to offset your future profits for 5 years. Well, if you're a new company, you've got losses for, you know, quite deep losses for some period of time. If you can carry it forward for 20 years, given the level of your losses when you first start up, you know, you can really offset your taxes. Now, is there a loss from that? Of course. You know, they've got some one-time bonus depreciation figures in there. There's some new tax credits. They've expanded some tax credits that used to be just for solar, for other manufacturing facilities. And I think the real concern was expressed by people like Ron Gould, who said, no, wait a second. Half of this bill came out at noon. It's 1:30. Why am I voting on this? This is how bad things happen. This is how we end up with mistakes. This is how we ended up with alt fuels, where we were suddenly giving credits for people to buy alternate fuel vehicles. And everyone said, you mean we didn't put a cap on that? And I think that's a scary part to a few people.
Is it a scary part to the governor, do you think?
No, because this was an agreement worked out with her office. The understanding had been that we'll get the budget done, and then they create what they call the box. And the idea was that there would be a total of about $20 million in tax savings in fiscal 14, and then 40 in the year after that. There are no tax cuts of any substance that are supposed to take place next year, because the governor's edict is that no tax cuts while my temporary sales tax is in place, and that runs for another year.
And so when the temporary sales tax conceivably ends, a lot of these tax breaks kick in. That's got some revenue issues there, doesn't it?
Oh, it's got some major revenue issues. And that goes away, just as all the stuff from the Arizona competitiveness package from last year, this massive omnibus economic development bill, all that goes into effect. We might have to start implementing the Affordable Care Act, Obamacare that year, which will cost a lot.
But again, it comes down to, what do you believe in your economic theory? There are people who believe that the tax cut package passed last year, which has not yet taken effect, has already created certain jobs of companies coming in here saying, well, look, the corporate income tax rate is going to go down. I'm willing to invest here. You know, there is something to be said for certain kinds of tax cuts do stimulate the economy, do bring in companies. The question becomes, which one? And there's a limit on that. I mean, if you take the Laffer curve to its illogical extension, that the lower you take your marginal taxes, the more your revenues you build in, we go to tax rate to zero, we must be infinitely wealthy.
But because, you know, partially because of these, the effect of these tax cuts kicking in, that's why the rainy day fund becomes all the more important. Now, the Republicans aren't going to say that, but they acknowledge that, you know, there's this cliff, and they're hoping, as they love to say, to turn it into a curb. So it's not such a tumble to go off of it.
Okay. All right. I haven't heard that one, so that's a good one. I like that one. We've heard a lot about the idea of a mortgage settlement fund that attorneys general around the country worked out. Arizona getting 97.7 some odd million as far as being able to use to help folks who are hurt by the financial crisis, the housing crisis, except...
Not anymore. Well, here's the deal. This was like a $26 billion nationwide settlement. Now, most of the money, including to Arizona, is actually going to the people who were foreclosed on, either to help them refinance or if they've already been foreclosed on to give them certain damages, I think up to $2,000 a person. We also got $97 million, which was supposed to go for counseling people, helping them navigate these various programs, giving them counseling, giving them legal help. Well, the legislature looked over and said, hey, this money's supposed to go for the state of Arizona. We're going to take half of it. Now, here's what gets real interesting. If you look at the contract that the Attorney General signed when he took the money, it spells out what it's supposed to be used for, and it seems to be fairly clear it's to help people. Horn is not going to raise a stink. There's going to be a lawsuit. Guess who's going to have to defend taking the money out of his own fund? Tom Horn.
Talk to us more about this, because I think people might be a little bit confused. The money was specifically designed to help folks for a specific purpose. The state is saying, well, we can help them to a certain degree with that purpose as well. And this money, by constitutional edict, is supposed to go to us.
Well, one of the things it says in the settlement is that the money is supposed to be used to ameliorate the effects of the foreclosure crisis. The legislature and the governor say, well, one of the biggest effects of the foreclosure crisis is we've lost a bunch of tax revenue. So, hey, that money's going to the state now. And, you know, look at all the things we would have cut otherwise.
Right. And to make people feel even a little bit better about this thing, and we'll, you know, try to direct that money to the Department of Real Estate, the Department of Insurance, you know, which have some kind of nexus with housing. But the problem is that once something's in the general fund, it's all the same soup. This is why this gets caught up with an argument about this money is being used to pay for private prisons. That was an initial thought, apparently, from around the negotiating table. Needed money for private prisons. Well, here's a place to get it. But once you dump that $50 million into the general fund, you could argue that it pays for whatever you want it to pay for.
Sounds like a lawsuit waiting to happen.
Oh, it's going to happen. Tim Hogan has already been contacted. We know how much Tim loves to sue. I'm sure he sat right here and told you how much he loves to sue the state.
True or not, Missouri, I saw Wisconsin, they may have had the same situation, and they may have used the money in the same fashion. Is that true?
Do we know that? Yeah, a couple of months ago, Missouri and Wisconsin both used most of that, their mortgage settlement money for that. Some other states, I think Pennsylvania and a couple others, have used small parts of it. The problem is, if you look at the settlement, it's a 48-state settlement, and every state has different criteria for how that money can be used. You know, some of them are very generic, you know, like Missouri and Wisconsin. Some of them are very specific, like Arizona's.
And that becomes an interesting issue. Tom Horn signed it on behalf of the state, said this is what we're using it for, and I asked him, I said, so does that make you in breach of contract? And he, of course, said, oh, of course not, Howie. You know, just typical lawyer.
He's going to be on both sides of the issue here. Interviewing himself as well as the defendant and the prosecutor.
Well, you've had him on, and he's been on both sides of the issue.
Well, let's move on. As far as Russell Pierce is concerned, and I mentioned Russell Pierce, but real technically this wasn't supposed to deal with Russell Pierce, but the idea of reimbursing candidates who are recalled, like Russell Pierce. this whole idea, this caught wind toward the end again, didn't it?
Yes, I guess if there was any sort of last-minute surprise or attempt, that this would be it. And there is a provision in the state constitution, as we said, I think we said this last week on the program, that allows for reimbursement of reasonable recall expenses of a candidate. There's never been statutory language that sort of clarifies, like, well, how would that work and how would you do that? So, you know, heeding now this constitutional call decades after it was written, lawmakers sat down on Wednesday and tried to hammer out some language. But the way it was written, it would be retroactive till November of 11. And if you remember what happened in November of 2011, there was a recall of a certain Senate president. This drew lots and lots of fire. And although the bill got out of a conference committee, it stopped there.
And it wasn't going to happen. I mean, look, Do you want to be the one to go home and seek re-election? Say, hey, one of the last things we did is we made sure Russell Pierce is in line for $260,000, even as we're cutting kids' care and everything else.
And yet, reports from Capitol reporters were that the caucus was pretty much split in half on this. Sounds like a lot of folks were willing to do that.
Oh, I think that there is a constitutional argument to be made. The Constitution says that the legislature shall make provision. There was a law in the books until the 1970s. I think it had like $500. It was a flat amount. They repealed the law. They never fixed it, even during the Meekham administration and his botched recall since he was impeached. And there is a legitimate reason to do this. Now, doing it right now, or as Ron Gould said to me, look, Howie, if we were doing this absent something else as just an academic thing, yeah, I'm all for obeying the Constitution. But to do it now, in one situation, not a good idea.
Jeremy, does this go to anyone who faces a recall, or does it go to an incumbent who wins the recall? And because it could be considered somewhat of a nuisance effort, they get reimbursed. I mean, does it just go to anyone who is recalled? That doesn't seem to make a heck of a lot of sense.
Well, we don't know. It's never been used, and that's part of the problem. Is, you know, Russell Pierce said, you know, this would go straight to my campaign. Other people aren't so sure. People don't know if it would violate campaign finance laws. People don't really know how this would work because it's never been done.
But I thought the way the Constitution is written, it would apply to any elected official who is recalled.
Win or lose.
Right. So it wouldn't apply like to a Jerry Lewis who was a challenger in a recall election.
No, but if Russell Pierce had won the election, it seems like that would make... Wouldn't that seem like
no,
that would
but,
make
but,
more
but
sense?
But again, that's not what the Constitution reads. The Constitution reads that way. Here's where it really gets interesting. Russell Pierce spent about $261,000, all of which came either from his leftover 2010 money or other donations. He did not spend any of his own money. Let's assume for argument's sake Russell were not going to run for election in 2012 and just had all this money. He'd already got his expenses paid for. It seems to me you run into a gift clause problem if now you're giving him $260,000 to reimburse him for money he never spent. And I think that complicated matters.
And not personal money either.
Yeah, it was all raised from individual contributors, political committees, a lot of lobbyists. And I was pretty surprised when I talked to Pierce last week about it. He said, yeah, you know, they have a constitutional duty to offer it, because that goes over great with Republican primary voters, giving government money to people's privately funded campaigns.
All right. Personnel reform, we mentioned that was one of the biggies there toward the end. Basically easier to hire and fire?
Yeah, I mean, essentially, the idea from the governor is, I want to make government more like private industry. In other words, you go to work at Capital Times, the Republic, if I had a major staff of my own, perhaps, at Capital Media Services. You know, I don't like the job you're doing. I can fire you. I don't have to give you procedural due process. I don't have to give you a hearing. There's no independent personnel board reviewing that. And the argument is that there are certain people who are not doing a good job. The other half of the argument is there are certain people who are doing a great job, but because of the way that the system is structured, if you're an administrative assistant 3, you get paid the same as every other administrative assistant 3. This allows somebody to be rewarded. Now, the flip side of that is if you kiss somebody's tush long enough, you're more likely to get rewarded. And that's that whole cronyism issue.
Or if you're an administrative official number 3 and you're doing just a bang-up job, but your supervisor's not so crazy about you, adios.
Adios. And that's the question that's raised. The governor's argument is, look, we have some state agencies that operate like that right now. Office of Tourism operates like that. Department of Gaming operates like that. And we haven't had issues of cronyism there. But there's still the fear that the reason these merit system protections were put in is the people who remember Chicago-style politics, the people who remember, hey, you helped me get elected. Would you like to become a department head?
Democrats were asking why the sense of urgency on this.
Well, Democrats, I think they probably would have opposed that no matter what. You could wait 10 years and they're still not going to like it. You know, Brewer tried to get this through last year, but it never really got much traction. She didn't really push very hard for it, and by the end of the session, no one was really happy with her anyway.
Do we know why that this is such an important thing for her? Because she has pushed this pretty hard twice now.
I don't know her.
She hasn't really just basically wants to make that change.
Yeah, I mean, you know, she says to make it more ease of hiring and firing, being able to reward good workers, and we've heard the talking points. I don't know if there's any motivation beyond that. And this will apply to all new hires, you know, going forward for people that are already in the system. The budget contained a one-time bonus for anybody that's willing to switch over and lose their protected status. It winds up being about a 3.75% one-time increase in your pay. Hmm. So,
and that's going to be interesting because the original plan by the governor was a permanent 5% increase in your base to give up your rights. Now, if I'm a state employee and I'm not so sure about what my boss is up to, okay, so I get a 3.7% increase over the course of a year, but then I go back to my other wages and I'm still stuck with the boss. Do I really want to give up these protections? I think it's going to be a hard sell.
Yes.
And this bill underwent actually one pretty significant change this week is law enforcement, DPS, Highway Patrol, that they'd been excluded from this. You know, no one wants to mess with cops, but they're politically popular. Everyone loves them. But the police agencies, their unions, have been arguing for months saying this should not affect our civilian employees. And, you know, the governor had been very resistant to changing that. There have been some folks, Republicans in the legislature, wanted to. And finally, they kind of gave in on that this week and excluded them as well. So they're not under this new system either.
Does that not suggest, if it's such a great idea, shouldn't everyone be involved?
Oh, but politics playing a role? I'm shocked at you, Ted.
All right, I'm shocked as well. Not so shocked, though, that Republicans seem to be going after the Independent Redistricting Commission yet again. And it sounds like, explain, giving the authority now for the legislature to sue?
Right. Both the House and Senate gave their respective leaders the authority to either intervene in existing lawsuits, there were two filed late last week on redistricting, or to file their own suit. Speaker Tobin, who's pretty much led this charge, has said that what he wants to do is challenge the congressional map. He doesn't want to mess with the district lines for this year's elections, but he believes that the U.S. Constitution says only the state legislatures can draw the lines, for at least for congressional races.
And this is going to be a fascinating argument because it does Article 4, Part 1 of the U.S. Constitution says, you know, that the job of drawing these lines is to the legislatures of the several states. Well, here's the problem. In Arizona in 2000, the people of the state of Arizona voted to give legislative authority to draw the lines to the commission. And you could make the argument that there is not just one legislature in Arizona, but that for the purposes of redistricting, there is actually a separate legislature.
And the Supreme Court, the U.S. Supreme Court, for 100 years has recognized, since the advent of these citizen initiatives in the progressive states in the West, that a citizen initiative is basically a legislative function. So there's a lot of debate over what does it mean by legislature. And the Supreme Court has said, well, a citizen vote is a legislative act.
Okay, so basically we've got the possibility of what, one-time election with the current maps, then something changes. The current maps could still be changed?
Could still be changed. Well, you've got a situation, and this happened a decade ago, where a three-judge federal panel set one set of legislative maps for the 2002 election, saying, okay, these are close enough, but we really want you to fix them, and a different set of maps for 2004. In fact, the lawsuit that's playing out in federal court over the legislative maps asked for a three-judge panel to draw different lines for the legislative races. Now, the problem they're going to have is pure time. The deadline for candidates to file is May 30th. They haven't even gotten a response from the state to the lawsuit to set the lines. I don't know at what point a court is going to say, well, yes, you've already filed for this district, but we're going to change the lines on you.
Very quickly, give me a headline for this legislative session.
The fleeting 50th. We had a lot of members who left either to pursue other offices or because of scandal, and we've got a lot more at the end who are going to leave, signaling the end of the supermajority.
Headline.
Special morality legislature. It wasn't guns or budget. It was issues of abortion and contraception and Bible studies. The moral majority took over at the Capitol.
Headline, Jeremy.
So long, supermajorities, we hardly knew you. They were very excited about this when they got elected in 2010, and they really didn't do much with it.
Interesting. All right, good stuff. Good to have you here. Thanks for joining us on Arizona Horizon. Monday on Arizona Horizon, business experts talk about what state lawmakers did to help or hinder Arizona's business and economic growth, and encouraging news regarding a just-released jobs forecast for Arizona. That's Monday at 7 on Arizona Horizon. Tuesday, how the state budget and new laws could impact K-12 and higher education. Wednesday, the Senate President and Speaker of the House talk about their legislative accomplishments. Thursday, the Artistic Director and Founder of Child's Play takes us inside the organization. And Friday, we are back with another edition of the Journalists' Roundtable. That is it for now. I'm Ted Simons. Thank you so much for joining us. You have a great weekend.